riding first class.
Good morning and welcome to Londonderry Christian Church. We're here to love one more. We're so glad you've chosen to join us this morning, whether it's here in person in the building or if you're watching online. We're so glad you've come to join and worship our great God with us. If this is your first time checking out Londonderry Christian Church or first time being with us, I encourage you to fill out our online connect card, which can be found in the comments on the Facebook video, or if you go to our website, londonderrychristianchurch.com, and click on connect, it'll bring that up and you can fill that card out. For each person who fills out a connect card, we're going to donate $5 to the Emmanuel Maria Foundation, who serves the community of Arad, Romania. So for everybody that fills out the card, we're going to give $5 away. So please fill out that card so we can do that. Also, I want to make you aware of some stuff that's happening this week. The first one is, hey, if you, for some reason, you start watching the service today and you have to stop, or if you'd like to rewatch it later in the week, we're going to have a replay of the service at 7 o'clock on Tuesday evening on YouTube. So go to our YouTube channel for Londonderry Christian Church, and you can watch the service again on Tuesday or invite friends to watch it for the first time. Then on Wednesday night at 8 p.m., we're going to have Wednesday night prayer on Facebook. You can join us as we're going to pray for stuff happening in our world and our lives. Then also on Friday nights, join us on Facebook for Friday Night Devo, where I'll share a devotional thought that hopefully will encourage us in our walk with Jesus. Then also this week coming up on Saturday, August 15th at 8 a.m., we're going to host a socially distanced men's breakfast. So all men are invited to come join us out in the parking lot. Bring a chair, bring your breakfast. We're going to sit outside and connect and talk while sitting 6 feet apart. Then also next Sunday, August 16th, we're encouraging everybody who's physically able to sign up for the day of service. So we're going to go around our community and serve Londonderry. So we're going to give back to our town. It's going to start next Sunday at 1:30 p.m., and we're going to serve in the afternoon until our projects are finished. So if you can go to our website, londonderrychristianchurch.com, click on events, and you can sign up for the day of service there. So today, in a few moments, we're going to sing some songs together. I encourage you, wherever you are, whether here in the building or watching online, join us as we sing. Then we're going to dig into God's Word and study and see what God's Word has to say to us today. And then later in our service, we're going to remember what Jesus has done for us in the act of And so if you didn't grab it on your way, be sure to get the little communion that we have sitting on the table. Or if you're at home, grab a piece of bread, tortilla, or a cracker, and some juice, milk, or water that you can use later for communion. Today we're continuing our new series called Keeping Your Faith in a World Gone Mad as we explore the book of Daniel. So if you would, please say our verse of the day with me. Praise be to the name of God forever and ever. Wisdom and power are His. He changes times and seasons. He deposes kings and raises up others. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to the discerning. Daniel chapter 2, verses 20 and 21. Let's pray. Father, may your Spirit be at work in us today as we gather together around your Son and your Word. Help us know that you are God over all and to learn how that truth can help us remain calm in stressful situations as we gather around the person of your Son. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thanks, Dave. Whether you're watching our live stream from home or in the parking lot or join us here in the building, let's stand and we'll sing some songs together this morning. how you love us. God, that you sent Jesus Christ as a sacrifice to redeem us, God, to restore us into right relationship with you. God, that you are our rescuer. And God, because of that, we can keep a cool head when the world around us seems like it's disintegrating, when the world around us seems like it's just not going the way that we want it to. God, because you are who you are, God, we can be safe and be secure, God, and we can be loved, God, and we can know that you are on the throne and that everything else is inconsequential. So, God, we thank you for who you are, for how you love your people, and it's your name that we pray. Amen. Amen. You be seated.
Good morning.
Morning.
Get us to dive into today. I want to start by taking a couple months to talk to our kids who are watching from home. So this week, we're talking about this big idea from the book of Daniel that God is in control. And to talk about this idea of God being in control, there's kind of a biblical word that we use to describe what happens when God is in control. That is, God's desire is to bring about peace. And so for English, we use the word peace to talk about this time of calm, of wholeness and healing. In Hebrew, the word for peace is shalom. And so in the old Bible, Old Testament, they use the word shalom. And today I want to teach you what peace means, or how to say peace in American Sign Language. At least this is what I saw online, so hopefully this is accurate. So peace in sign language is you take your hands and you clasp them together, and then you smooth it out. So peace. And what I really like about this sign is that when you start, you're clasping your hands. It's like things aren't good. There's tension, there's fear, there's pain, and you clasp them again. But then it ends with smoothing it all out nice and calm. It reminds me of a verse from Scripture, from Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7, where it says, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." That for you kids, there may be things happening in your lives that you feel afraid. You may feel like you're not calm, like you don't have peace. And what the Bible reminds us is that we can know that God is good and is over all things, and so he can give us peace that passes understanding. He can help calm us down and make things smooth that may be causing us fear. And so my hope this week is that you can give your fears to God, whatever's making you afraid. Maybe it's the thought of school coming in a few weeks. Maybe it's all the stuff that you hear, maybe your mom or dad talk about the coronavirus, or maybe it's other stuff going on that you can't see your friends or haven't been able to do things you want to do, and that's all making you afraid. But one of the things you can do is you can turn to God in prayer and ask for him to help give you peace, to help him make things calm in your life. And so I love that sign of peace, where God can bring calm to our lives. So I pray that you can put that into practice this weekend. And thanks for joining us this morning. Have you noticed that when things start to go off the rails, or things go wrong in our world, that some people aren't very good at handling it when things get really stressful? That when things get stressful or chaotic, some people don't seem to know what to do. They panic, which only makes things worse. And I was thinking about this week, talking about this idea of God being in control and trying to stay calm in stressful situations. That made me think of a mini-series I watched a few years ago. It's a true story about Easy Company. It's the mini-series Band of Brothers that HBO had produced. And in the story of Easy Company, it's this group of men who were preparing to go fight in World War II. And at the very beginning, their commander is Lieutenant Sobel. Sobel was a hard man who pushed Easy Company in training. Like, he was wanted them to be the best outfit in their division. He wanted them to be the very best company in the war. And so he pushed them really hard. And sometimes too hard. He could be petty and vindictive. There are scenes in the miniseries where he does a spot inspection, and for the slightest infraction, he'd revoke their weekend passes. And if too many people had infractions, he made them all go change in their PT, and they went run Kurahi up the mountain and back. He was great at training. His training, while difficult, made them into be one of the best companies during the war that was able to endure the war. But when it came to being out in the field commanding his men, was not good. There's a scene in the movie where they're doing a field exercise, and they've set up in a perfect ambush position. And they keep waiting for the enemy to approach, keep waiting. And Lieutenant Sobel becomes convinced that they're out of position. That the reason the enemy's not coming is because they're not in the right spot. And so he commands the men to get up and we're going to move. And one of his officers comes and says, no, we're in the perfect spot. We're in textbook position. And he overrules them and says, no, we're moving. And he gets them and they start moving through the woods to a new position. And as they're going, they themselves walk into an ambush. And the officer in charge of the exercise says that 95% of the company would have been killed had it been real. Later on, they show a scene where they're on a training mission in England, preparing to go fight and to go over to Europe before long. And so he's leading them through the countryside, and they get lost. And they come to a barbed wire fence that's not on the map that he has. And while he's trying to figure out where he is, they realize they're a full grid off from where they're supposed to be. One of the men impersonates the major who's in charge of all of them and tells Sobel to cut the fence and keep going. And so later on in headquarters, there's a bunch of head of cattle that have come to headquarters, and the officers in charge are not happy. And so he was somebody that when it got really stressful, he panicked. He didn't know what to do. He lost his head and didn't do the right things. That we know some people in our lives who, when things get stressful, they wilt under pressure, or they get really angry and they lash out, or they run away and they go hide. And that what we're going to see as we look at the book of Daniel today is that as things get stressful, that we want to keep our heads, that we want to learn how to remain cool and calm and collected the best we can as our life gets stressful. That we want to keep our heads in stressful situations. We see this lived out in the life of Daniel. In Daniel and his friends, we come to chapter 2, where we're going to see how Daniel responds, and then how others respond to a very stressful situation. So we're going to dig into Daniel chapter 2. And the first thing we're going to see two ways that we shouldn't respond. Then we're going to look at Daniel's response, and how and why he responds the way he does. But the first thing we see, what we should not do, is don't lose your head in fear. That when you encounter a stressful situation, don't lose your head in fear. Look at Daniel chapter 2, starting off in verse 1. Daniel chapter 2, starting off in verse 1, says, in the second year of his reign, Nebuchadnezzar had dreams. His mind was troubled, and he could not sleep. So the king summoned the magicians, enchanters, sorcerers, and astrologers to tell him what he had dreamed. When they came in and stood before the king, he said to them, I have had a dream that troubles me, and I want to know what it means. Have you ever had a nightmare or a bad dream that troubled you? Had that experience where you're sleeping, and all of a sudden you wake up, and you're convinced, like you're convinced that what just happened was real. And you have to kind of talk yourself down or walk yourself back from that mental ledge of like, okay, that wasn't real. Like, one, what happened was crazy. Like, there aren't real 30-foot monsters chasing me. That's not real. Or I'm not falling off a cliff or whatever. And when that's happened to me, I kind of have to think through all the things going on in the dream that are not real. And then I get to the last point, which is, I'm laying in bed right now. Like, it's kind of like the point that finally solidifies that I'm okay is that I look at where I am. Okay, I'm in bed. I was dreaming. But there are times that you have dreams that are so vivid, so real, and what they're saying can be so troubling that they shake us. And that's what happened to King Nebuchadnezzar. He has this dream that is so terrifying to him that it troubles him. So he calls in all of his wise men, hey, come tell me my dream. I want to know what my dream was and what it means. And as the king begins to interact with his wise men, he begins to get more and more angry because he's afraid. That he reacts to the fear of his dream with anger. Often when we encounter a frightening or a stressful situation, we have one of three responses. Either we respond in anger, which is the fight response, or we respond with fear, we run away, the flight response, or we respond with the freeze response, that we can't do anything. And here we see the king loses his head in fear, and he responds by fighting. He becomes combative with his wise men, and it gets so bad that he moves to a place where he decrees that they're going to have to be executed because they won't tell him what his dream was. That we live in a time right now that if you're facing or have been facing heightened fear and anxiety, That's expected. We're living in this time right now with COVID-19, racial unrest, and political strife, that things are crazy. We live in a world gone mad. It seems like our world has gone crazy. And it's okay to recognize that you have heightened levels of fear and anxiety, but what we need to do is figure out how do we respond to our stressful situation and remain calm in the midst of all the craziness. And so the king responds in anger and fear, not how we're called to respond. The next response we see is from the wise men, and they respond with stubbornness. So we don't want to respond like them. We don't want to lose our heads in stubbornness. Look at Daniel chapter 2, verse 4. It says, then the astrologers answered the king, may the king live forever. Tell your servants the dream and we will interpret it. The king replied to the astrologers, this is what I have firmly decided. If you do not tell me what my dream was and interpret it, I will have you cut into pieces and your houses turned into piles of rubble. But if you tell me the dream and explain it, you will receive from me gifts and rewards and great honor. So tell me the dream and interpret it for me. Once more they replied, let the king tell his servants the dream and we will interpret it. And the king answered, I am certain that you're trying to gain time because you realize that I have firmly decided. If you do not tell me the dream, there's only one penalty for you. You've conspired to tell me misleading and wicked things, hoping the situation will change. So then, tell me the dream and I will know that you can interpret it for me. The astrologers answered the king, there's no one on earth who can do what the king asks. No king, however great and mighty, has ever asked such a thing of any magician or enchanter or astrologer. What the king asks is too difficult. No one can reveal it to the king except the gods, and they do not live among humans. This made the king so angry and furious that he ordered the execution of all the wise men of Babylon. So the decree was issued to put the wise men to death, and men were sent to look for Daniel and his friends to put them to death. The king responds in fear and anger to his dream, and he orders the wise men, hey, tell me the dream. And they say, I can't. I can't do it. I don't know what the dream is or was. Only the gods can do that. We're not capable of that. This is an impossible task. So the king, tell us your dream. And the king says, no, you tell me the dream. And both sides dig in their heels in stubbornness and will not respond in calm with the other. And it gets so bad that the king decides that they're going to be executed. He's going to kill all of his wise men. All of the wise advisors he has are all going to be put to death because they won't tell him his dream. Things spin out of control, and they each respond by digging in their heels and throwing fits over what they want. They've all lost their heads. Neither the king or his wise men are responding in ways that will help the stressful situation they're in. So that's what we shouldn't. Don't lose your head in fear. Don't lose your head in stubbornness. So what do we do? How do we respond to stressful situations in ways that glorify and honor God? What we need to do is we must keep our heads by recognizing that God is in control. Keep your head by recognizing that God is in control. Look at how Daniel responds to the situation. Look at Daniel chapter 2, starting in verse 14. It says, when Arioch, the commander of the king's guard, had gone out to put to death the wise men of Babylon, Daniel spoke to him with wisdom and tact. He asked the king's officer, why did the king issue such a harsh decree? Arioch then explained the matter to Daniel. At this, Daniel went into the king and asked for time so he might interpret the dream for him. Then Daniel returned to his house and explained the matter to his friends, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. He urged him to plead for mercy from the God of heaven concerning this mystery, so that he and his friends might not be executed with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. The king loses his head. The wise men lose their head and are about to lose their heads. And so they come to tell Daniel, hey, you're going to die too. And it says Daniel keeps his head. It says he spoke to the official with wisdom and tact. That somehow, some way, for some reason, Daniel can stay calm in the midst of this very stressful situation. And the reason Daniel can remain calm is because he and his friends recognize and they live out their core conviction. They believe that God is in control. That most likely, Daniel, when he hears this edict, or this decree of the king, he's probably afraid. His life is on the line, but rather than throw a fit or make things worse, being angry and trying to fight back at the king, Daniel goes to his friends and says, okay, we know God is in control, so let's respond the right way. And they gather together and he urges them, he pleads with his friends, hey, pray with me. That they go to plead to the God of heaven, the only one who has the power to spare their lives is Yahweh, King of all things. They go to God and say, God, give us mercy, save our lives. They recognize and live out that God is in control. That when we encounter stressful situations in our lives, the ways that we can keep our heads and try to stay as calm as possible is to recognize that God is in control. He's the one over all things. He's the great God that we turn to. And so we see throughout the rest of this chapter how Daniel is able to live out his faith in God and how God demonstrates his control in Daniel's life. That Daniel trusts God and recognizes God's control because he knows that Yahweh reveals truth to those who seek him. That we can stay calm because we recognize that Yahweh reveals truth to those who seek him. Look at Daniel chapter 2, starting in verse 19. It says, during the night, the mystery was revealed to Daniel in a vision. Then Daniel praised the God of heaven and said, praise be to the name of God forever and ever. Wisdom and power are his. He changes times and seasons. He deposes kings and raises others up. He gives wisdom to the wise, knowledge to the discerning. He reveals deep and hidden things. He knows what lies in darkness, and light dwells with him. I thank and praise you, God of my ancestors. You've given me wisdom and power. You've made known to me what was asked of you. You have made known to us the dream of the king. That Daniel and his friends, they go before God, they seek God, they recognize that the revealer of truth, the only one that can reveal this mystery of a dream, is Yahweh, God of all things. And when God reveals the dream, Daniel praises God as the one who gives wisdom and knowledge, the revealer of deep and hidden things. He's the one who reveals truth. Later on in the story, the king begins to praise Daniel for telling him his dream, and Daniel stops him and says in verse 27, he says, no wise man, enchanter, magician, or diviner can explain to the king the mystery he's asked about, but there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries. He has shown King Nebuchadnezzar what will happen in days to come. Your dream and visions that pass through your mind as you were lying in bed are these. Daniel credits Yahweh as being the one who reveals the dream to him. It wasn't Daniel, but God who revealed the dream. That Yahweh is the one who reveals truth to those who seek him. This is echoed in the New Testament when Jesus tells his disciples that the Holy Spirit would be given to us, who would be our guide and who would guide us into all truth. That we have been given this amazing gift of the Holy Spirit, who will remind us of Jesus' teachings and will lead us to truth. That if we seek truth, God will reveal truth to us through the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit reveals to us that truth is not just a thing to be known, but a person to be in relationship with. That Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. That he is truth. And so as we seek truth, we seek Jesus, and the Holy Spirit leads us into greater relationship with Christ. So we can trust in God, we can keep our head in stressful situations because God is in control and he reveals truth to those who seek him. The next thing we see why Daniel could stay calm to keep his head in a stressful situation is because Yahweh raises and lowers kingdoms. That Yahweh raises and lowers kingdoms. That the king's dream that so troubled King Nebuchadnezzar was the dream of a great statue. And the head of the statue was made of brilliant gold. The arms and the chest was made of silver. The belly and thighs was made of bronze. The legs were of iron, and the feet were of iron and baked clay. And in the vision, he sees this rock cut from a mountain, not cut by human hands, that falls and it crushes the feet of the statue, and it grows bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger, and eventually it smashes the entire statue to bits. And this vision is of kingdoms and how people view kingdoms, that we view power and wealth like precious metal, that power is like a precious metal that we seek after. And God is telling the king that Yahweh is the one who raises and lowers kingdoms. That whether the kingdom of Babylon will rise or fall isn't Nebuchadnezzar's hands. It's in Yahweh's hands. He is the one who is in charge, who brings kingdoms to rise and to fall. In the last few weeks, I've had conversations with friends who are really, really worried and stressed out about the upcoming presidential election. They each have their preferred political party and presidential candidate, and each have this feeling that if their party or candidate doesn't win the election, it's over. Just consider America done. Stick a fork in us. It's going to be game over. And then they're so stressed, so worried, so angry and upset that, man, just if we don't win, it's all over. And I can't imagine what's going to happen. And while having strong opinions and passions about politics can be a good thing, part of what Daniel's trying to help us see is that whether a kingdom rises or falls, it's not on us. I mean, yes, you should do your best to be informed on the issues and the candidates. You should do your civic duty and go vote. But what happens, rising or falling of our country, that's up to God. He's the one in charge of that. And where we place our faith isn't on who sits behind the resolute desk in the White House. It's who's on the throne reigning over all things. And whether a candidate I like wins or doesn't, whether policies I like are enacted or aren't, what matters most for me is that my king is on the throne. And there's no vote that's going to take place that's going to take him off his throne. That he's the one who's overseeing all things. And whether we as people go through hard times or less hard times, he's still going to be king. He's still going to lead us and bring us through to where he wants us to be. Are there some things I wish would happen because it makes my life easier? Sure. But as a follower of Jesus, I'm not guaranteed an easy life. Actually, Jesus says the opposite. That in this world, we will have trouble. That for Christians, we should expect difficulty. And that we have our God who will lead us through that, who will be with us through that. Daniel trusts in God. He sees God in control, that God's the one raising and lowering kingdoms. Not Daniel, not Nebuchadnezzar. And the last thing we see here, that where we can stay calm in stressful situations, is that Yahweh's kingdom endures forever. Look at Daniel chapter 2, verse 44. It says, in the time of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed, nor will it be left to another people. It will crush all those kingdoms and bring them to an end, but it will itself endure forever. This is the meaning of the vision of the rock cut out of a mountain, but not by human hands. A rock that broke the iron, the bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold to pieces. The great God has shown the king what will take place in the future. The dream is true, and its interpretation is trustworthy. The final kingdom in the vision is the kingdom of God. And that kingdom will continue to grow and expand no matter what happens. Nothing will stop that kingdom. And that kingdom advances, not like others, through military force or violence. Instead, the kingdom of Yahweh grows and reigns through self-sacrificial love and service. I love to see how Daniel and his friends respond in this time of stress. They don't take up arms to fight. They don't run away and hide. Instead, they fall to their knees and pray. This week, I started reading a new book by N.T. Wright called God and the Pandemic. And in it, he talks about that the way followers of Jesus are called to respond in the midst of this stressful time is through prayer. He says it means that when the world is going through great convulsions, the followers of Christ are to be called people of prayer at the place where the world is in pain. He says, Paul puts it like this. in a three-stage movement. First, the groaning of the world. Second, the groaning of the church. And third, the groaning of the Spirit within the church, within the world. He says, this is the ultimate answer, I think, to those who want to say that the present coronavirus crisis is a clear message from God, which we cannot once decode, either as a sign of the end, a culture of repentance, or simply an opportunity for a standard kind of evangelism. What he's trying to say is that what we're called to do as God's people is that when our world is in pain, that we don't point out that this is a punishment from God, that we don't say it's a sign of the end, but we recognize it's a time of pain for our world, and that we are to enter into the pain of our world in prayer. He looks at Romans 8, where it says that when we don't know what to pray, the Spirit groans with us in our pain. That part of what we do as we respond is we bear the pain of our world, and we take it before our Father and say, God, we're in so much pain. There are people who are getting sick and dying from this pandemic. There's racial unrest in our country over black and white and other races. That there's political strife between the left and the right, Republicans and Democrats. All this pain. And God, we don't know what to do with the pain, but we bring it to you in prayer. And say, Father, here's our pain. And the Spirit in us is groaning alongside us. That what we're called to do is not to spectate, sit on the sidelines and watch, not to benefit from what's happening, but to be actively participating with God in prayer, in laboring with God, and in giving our time and our energy to serve, and in love to seek the best for all that we can. Yahweh's people are called to co-labor with Him in this world by giving of ourselves, by serving our communities, and by loving all. That if we can do this, we can keep our head in stressful situations like Daniel, living out our core conviction that God is in control. That when we live as people who firmly believe that God is in control, we're able to pray and groan for when our world is in pain. We're able to give our time and our energy in service to our community. We're able to seek God's best at cost to ourselves and love for those we meet. That we can keep our head by being people of prayer, people who serve, and people who love the world that we're in. We're called to keep our heads by recognizing God is in control. And so we pray, so we serve, and so we love. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you love us so much, that you've sent your Son to be with us, to be our example. God, we pray that we could live like Him, to keep our heads in stressful situations. God, help us be people who give and serve and love and pray. And God, help us to groan where our world groans, to meet the needs that we can, and to love others in the ways that we can, to show them who you are. God, empower us to live as your people who keep our heads in stressful times. We thank you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please stand when I sing a song. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is the light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. God, we thank you so much, God, that it is by your power that we stand, God, that it's you who are in control, and because of that, God, we can stay calm, cool, and collected, God, that we don't have to lash out in anger or frustration, but God, that when we recognize that you are on the throne, that you are in control, God, that we can sit back and have the peace that comes from knowing who you are, and peace that comes through faith in your Son, Jesus Christ. God, as we get ready to celebrate communion, God, we are so thankful that Christ suffered and died and rose again so that we could be connected with you, God, so that we could experience peace in this life. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. Amen.
Think about enduring stressful situations. Think about Jesus. As he faced what's possibly the most stressful situation of all, he took his disciples and they went to the Garden of Gethsemane. He took his closest friends out of the bunch and said, come and pray with me. And he goes a little bit farther beyond them and he goes before the Father in prayer. As he looks ahead to the cross where his life will be taken, where he will bear our sin, he doesn't lash out in anger. He doesn't run away and hide. He doesn't freeze. Instead, he cries out in prayer, Father, take this cup from me, but not as I will. Your will be done. Three times he prays. Three times resolves to do the Father's will. Which led him the next day to the cross, where our sins are placed upon him, and that we are now able to enter new life with hope for life beyond the grave because he took our sin. Every week we have this time to remember what Jesus has done for us through his death and his resurrection. If you have your communion, go ahead and peel the top layer off and take the bread out. Or if you're at home, grab your bread, tortilla, or cracker. As we remember the body of Christ that was broken for us, let's take it together. You open up your juice. We have your juice, water, and milk from home. As we remember the blood of Christ that was poured out for us, let's take it together. Every week we have an opportunity to respond to this amazing thing God has done for us through giving. That here at Londonderry Christian Church, we give not because it buys our ticket to heaven or because it is, earns our salvation, that we give so that through our giving we can help one more person, and one more person, and one more person discover God's amazing love. That all that we do as a church, the goal of what we do, is not just to make ourselves feel comfortable or happy, was that so what we can do, we can help those who don't yet know Christ encounter his love and begin a relationship with him. And so there are a variety of ways you can give to help us in our mission to love one more. You can give as you leave. We have an offering box. You can place your giving in a box. You can go online and give on our website, LondonderryChristianChurch.com, or you can set up online regular giving through your bank as well. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you sent your Son and that you now give us this opportunity to respond to what Jesus has done for us through giving. That our giving, Lord, is done as a way to say thank you for what you've done for us, and so that what we give can be used to help one more person, and one more person, and one more person discover your amazing love. God, that we want to be people who share in telling the good news to others, that we share by what we do and what we say so that other people can encounter Jesus and begin to follow him. So Father, we pray you'll take what we give today and help it to help one more person discover your amazing love. It's in Jesus' name we pray, amen. As we close, I want to say thank you again for joining us today, whether here on in person or online. And again, a few reminders, if you'd like to connect with our church, you can fill out the online connect card on our website or on the Facebook video comments. Also, you can join us Wednesday night for Wednesday night prayer at 8 p.m. and Friday night Devo on Fridays at 8. And please, if you would sign up for the day of service coming up next Sunday at 1:30, if you go to our website, LondonderryChristianChurch.com, click events, you can sign up for the day of service there. So thank you for joining us today as we remember that God is in control, that his kingdom will endure forever. Let's pray. Father, thank you that you're God over all, that you're in the same place you've always been, that you're seated on your throne. May we be your people who groan with the pain of our world, serve to meet the needs of our world, and do our best to love the people of your world. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Have a great week and keep finding ways to love one more.
Yeah, it was like a short thing. I don't know if it still is.
We'll find out.